Well, the answer is obvious. It's designed for the ceiling. All right. So it's a ceiling lamp, ceiling lighting fixture. All right. So that means that we eliminated this level. Now we can go back to the next level and ask ourselves a question. Is it made out of base metal or is it not made out of base metal? Now we are in a world of GRI 3. So through GRI 6, we have to have GRI 3 analysis because we have both plastic plus metal components. At this level, so this is GRI 1 level. So through GRI 6 we eliminated this because terms of the heading were enough. At this level we became GRI 3. Plastic or metal, which one is more important? It is difficult to say because both are equally important. Ornamental, utilitarian, aesthetic, and one which provides the whole function. And what do we know? So we know that we cannot use rule of relative specificity, GRI 3a. We cannot use rule of essential character, GRI 3b, because plastic is just as essential as metal. So we go with what? We go with GRI 3c. GRI 3c says you go with the last one in numerical order. So here, which one is last in numerical order? It's usually the one at the bottom. So it would not be base metal, it would be other. Right? This is GRI 3C. This is how we got there. So the next question is it used for household or is it not used for household? And because we know it is used in homes, we choose this household. Notice the significance of this analysis. Hugely significant. Because remember, the duty rate is determined at the 8-digit level, which means the duty rate is decided at the subheading level. This means that a lot of fight, a lot of analytical struggle will be dealt not at necessarily at the heading level, but at the subheading level. In the situation with the light fixture, this was just the case. The breaking point was a metal versus plastic. Because if we found metal, let's say metal, the argument was made, and customs made that argument before, that metal is essential because without metal, the whole lamp would not function. And because metal was held to be essential, what happened here? Well, let's say it wasn't brass. Brass is copper. It usually is steel, right? The hinges, the housing. So if it's made out of base metal, it goes directly here. And if it's made for household, it's classified under this provision, which is 7.6% duty. However, if plastic, if we classify it as plastic, not because plastic is essential, but because plastic is last in numerical order, then the duty jumps down to 3.9%. If you import millions and millions dollars worth of merchandise, this is a huge chunk of money. So if you have a client which is struggling with the decision about this, it is very important to engage through this analysis and come to the decision which is currently, after the lawsuit brought by Home Depot against the United States in mid-2000s, the court said, look, both components are equally important. in the products that were discussed. So we're going to stick with the last numerical order. And it was a win for Home Depot because instead of 7.6% duty, now it could pay 3.9% duty. I think this is not really to pinpoint a particular company or entity. What's interesting here is the analytical background. And this whole analytical background focused really on GRI 3 within the domain of GRI 6. So this is an example of how GRI 6 can, other GRIs, GRIs 1 through 3, can link through the GRI 6 door and become very important at the subheading level. Any questions? So we have another clause here. Unless, again, remember those weird words that drafters of the harmonized tariff schedule put in, however, subject to, and of course, general rule of interpretation 6 is not an exception. They usually finish unless the context otherwise requires. So one is left to wonder, what context? What is otherwise required? What is the does that phrase mean? So let me give you an example of the context that is otherwise required. And the context is provided where? It is provided in section and chapter notes. So take a look at the chapter 71, note 2, and note 4. So you have a subheading note and you have chapter note. Look at the chapter note. The expression platinum means platinum, iridium, osmium, palladium, rhodium, and ruthenium. So here in chapter 71 you have definition of platinum, which includes palladium, let's say. And then look at the subheading note, which says, and subheading note is legally binding according to GRI-6, which says expression platinum does not include palladium. So here the platinum includes palladium, here the platinum does not include palladium. So how do you reconcile that? Well, remember, unless the context otherwise requires, right? And I think this would be an example of that otherwise requires, because there's a special carve-out provision, which is specifically to subheadings 7110.11, 7110.19. And only for those subheadings, the word platinum does not include iridium, osmium, palladium, rhodium, ruthenium. In all others within the chapter, it does. But here, it does not. So you have like a rule within a rule. That would be, I think, a good example of otherwise requires. And in a way, that would make sense. And why would it make sense? Let's take a look at chapter 71 to see how it is structured. Okay. Look. Here, the way the HTS is broken out is you have platinum provision and palladium and rhodium iridium provision as a separate line items at the same level. It's just the way the HTS is structured. So if you were to apply the first rule where platinum includes all those, you would have a huge confusion, right? But here, in this case, it kind of makes sense if you break it out and create a special rule for platinum, where platinum does not include those items. And only then you can reconcile the classification under these provisions. Yeah? So that would be an example of the unless context otherwise requires. HTS can get complex, and its complexity can mean that you have a situation where it's difficult for you to reconcile unless you make specialty carve-outs for the particular product. In this situation, it would be platinum. Any questions? Thank you.